Good morning, New York Valley. Wow, I am way on up there. Turn me down just a little bit. Holy cow. It's good to be in God's house this morning. We're so grateful for your presence. It is not always easy to live the way God wants us to live. It is not always easy to find time to pray and read our Bibles every day. The scripture says there are people who can help us. A great cloud of witnesses, they are called. People from every time and place who have tried hard to live the way God wanted them to live. We can learn from their lives how to be faithful to God. Sometimes we call these people saints. Yes, saints aren't perfect people. When we try to do things that God wants us to do, when we love God and follow Jesus, we can be saints too. We can be saints too. That's good news. Loving God, thank you for your saints in history and those today who help show us what it means to live according to your will. Help us to follow their example and be part of your cloud of witnesses. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And if our young folks would come for a moment. Pastor. You ever seen anybody in a weight room lifting weights, doing this whole thing with big weights? One time my son, he thought he was going to be a bodybuilder, my oldest son, and he bought this set of weights. And it had a bench. And he laid down on the bench and he put the weights on this bar that was above him and he would lift them up and then do this kind of stuff and then put them back in the holder so he could get out. But one day he was working in his bedroom on his weights and all of a sudden I hear him call, "Dad, help!" And I went running to his room and he was laying on that bench and those bars were right up against his neck. And he couldn't quite get them back up into place. And I had to reach down and try. And I could hardly help him get the weights back into place. So, I needed God's strength and he needed my help. There's a guy in the Bible that's like that. He was the biggest bodybuilder ever. Anybody know what his name was, perchance? Jane does, but I'm not going to call on her. Anybody else? Samson. I keep hearing it in the background. Yes, Samson. And he didn't work out to get his strength. You know that? He got it by a gift from God. There was a man named let me read this and make sure I'm getting it pronounced right. Manoah. And he and his wife had no children. And God promised them a son, but they told him they had to dedicate him to them, and he would become what they called a Nazarite, which means he would not drink any strong wine, and he would let his hair grow out. When I was a teenager, I wanted to be a Nazarite, but my parents didn't like that too good. But he let his hair grow out, and he became strong. As long as his hair was long, he was strong. And one day, he was attacked by a bunch of evil people, and he picked up the job, or no, he was attacked by a lion. And when you were attacked by a lion, if you were attacked by a lion, what would happen? You'd die, yeah. But Samson killed the lion. And then one day, a group of people were out to get him, and he picked up the jawbone of an ass, a donkey, rather. I shouldn't say things like that in church, but anyway. Jawbone of a donkey, and he killed 1,000 Philistines. And one time, there were people that had tried to attack him, and it made him mad, and he got 100 foxes. And he tied their tails together. Yeah, you've seen foxes. Grabbing one is a funny thing. 100 of them. He tied their tails together, set their tails on fire, and shooed them off through the crops of these people and got his revenge on them. But he fell in love with a girl who wasn't so much in love with him. And her friends kept saying, "Find out why Samson is so strong." So she did, through a series of things that I won't go into, but it's a whole process, because he kept telling her one thing and it was not true, and she would tell the people and he would break free, and he never got the message that she was trying to get him. And one day she wore him down, and he said, "If I lose my hair, then I'll lose my strength." And so she called in the barber, and they cut off his hair, and then they took him away, and they put him in chains, and they put out his eyes, and they made him work at the mill and grinding all day long. And they made fun of him because he used to be this big, strong guy, and now he's a wimp and a weakling. But all the time they kept doing that, his hair kept growing longer and longer and longer. And one day they decided they'd have some great fun, and they brought him out in front of the temple that they had to their gods, Baal and Asheroth and a bunch of others. And they chained him between the two pillars. And they were spitting and whipping and making fun and doing all kinds of bad things. And Samson prayed a prayer. He said, "God, give me strength one more." And God gave him strength, and he pushed those pillars out from that temple wall, and the walls fell down and killed thousands of people, wiped them out. Samson was one of God's judges. He had been risen up to lead Israel out of some of their torment from the Philistines. Samson, as long as he was listening to God, was a strong man and did mighty things. But when he quit listening to God and listen to his girlfriend instead, he found himself in trouble. Now, what lesson can we learn from that story? It should be real easy. What? Listen to God and do what he says, and he will always protect you and give you strength. You don't need to be a strong man to work out and all of that. He will give you the strength you need. Can we pray together? Join me if you would. Don't. He's fine. In Judges chapter 6, I'll be reading verse 11 through 17. That's found on page 223 in the Old Testament portion of your pew Bible. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under an oak at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abizrite, as his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide from the Midianites. The angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." And Gideon answered him, "But, sir, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our ancestors recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has cast us off, given us into the hands of Midian." The Lord turned to him and said, "Go in this might of yours and deliver Israel from the hand of Midian. I hereby commission you." And he responded, "But sir, how can I deliver Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." And the Lord said to him, "But I will be with you, and you shall strike down the Midianites, every one of them." Then the Lord said to him, "If now I have found favor with you," "If now I have found favor with you, then show me a sign that it is you who speak to me." The word of God, written by God, for the people of God. Amen. Why did the chicken cross the road? That's the common answer to get to the other side. Dr. Seuss would probably answer the question this way: did the chicken cross the road? Did it cross it with a toad? Why the chicken crossed the road, I have not been told. My grandpa, would answer it like this: in my day, we didn't ask why. Someone told us it crossed the road, and that was good enough for us. Einstein would have said, did the chicken cross the road, or did the road move beneath the chicken? Or you could probably look in Scripture and it would sound something like this: God cometh down from heaven and saith to the chicken, "Thou shalt cross the road." And the chicken crossed the road, and there was much rejoicing. Or the West Texan might say, to prove to the armadillo that it could be done. Now that's only funny, really, if you know that when an armadillo is frightened, it doesn't run this way or that way, it just jumps straight up. So the question is, why? Why? Joshua is dead and the time is past, and all those who had seen the great works of God had passed away, and a new generation had rose that had not witnessed firsthand the power of God, and so they forgot and forgot and forgot. In the book of Judges, we find Israel secure in the land for a time, and then again and again, they would find themselves oppressed by some nation that had been untouched in the conquest of the promised land. And they begin to keep asking the question, why? Now, in the lower story, it seemed that God had worked miraculously to get them into Canaan, but then had deserted them. Judges 6:13 says this: Gideon answered him, "But sir, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? And where are the wonderful deeds that our ancestors recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Israel, from Egypt?' And now the Lord has cast us off and given us into the hand of Midian." Gideon was asking why. Gideon was the fourth in the line of several judges that we see in the book of Judges. And the Lord came to Gideon, and Gideon asked why. And then, somewhat argumentatively, why me? He said, my clan is the weakest, and I am the least in my family. Gideon was wondering, as well as all of Israel. You see, for over 330 years since Joshua had died, Israel had been repeatedly oppressed by surrounding countries. Israel felt that they had been abandoned for no good reason, or so they thought. In the 330 years that had passed since Joshua died, Israel had been oppressed by several surrounding countries. They had been oppressed by Mesopotamia for 8 years, by the Moabites for 18 years, by the Canaanites for 20 years, the Midianites for 7 years, the Ammonites for 18 years, and the Philistines for 40 years, 110 out of the 330. So why were they over and over again oppressed, and why did God have to repeatedly raise up a judge to lead them to freedom? Well, the answer is found in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 19 through 22. God predicted to Moses 30 years before they even took possession of the land. Now, therefore, he said to Moses, write this song and teach it to the Israelites. Put it in their mouths in order that this song might be a witness for me against the Israelites, for what I have brought them into the land of flowing with milk and honey, which I promised on an oath to their ancestors, and they have eaten their fill and grown fat, and they will turn to other gods and serve them, despising me and breaking my covenant. And when many terrible troubles come upon them, this song will confront them as a witness, because it will not be lost from the mouths of their descendants. For I know what they are inclined to do even now, before I even brought them into the land that I promised them that very day, that I promised them on an oath. And that very day, Moses wrote this song and taught it to the Israelites. So you see, in the upper story, God knew in advance that they either couldn't or wouldn't do their part, would not keep up their end of the covenant. Oppression came because they did not keep their end of the bargain. Under Joshua, they had followed God and listened to God and done great things. Judges 2:10, however, tells us, moreover, the whole generation was gathered to their ancestors, and another generation grew up after them who did not know the Lord or the work he had done for Israel. In the upper story, Israel is a major part of God's story, his plan. Through that, he will reveal himself, his presence, his power, and his plan to get the people back. But over and over again, they did evil in the eyes of the Lord and massively distorted the identity of God and the beautiful works and the beautiful life that works when God is in the center of your life. God warned them that he would be obligated to discipline or remove his protective hand. This is the why. This is why the trouble. You see, they fell into a cycle that we often fall into even today. The cycle goes like this. Number one, Israel sinned. After a while, Israel is oppressed by a surrounding nation. Eventually, Israel would cry out to the Lord. Then Israel would eventually repent. And when they repented, God would raise up a judge to deliver them. He raised up Othniel, Caleb's younger brother, then Ehud, then Deborah. Deborah's a great story. Deborah said to Barak, take your army and go out and crush the enemy. And he said, I'll do it, but only if you come with me. Now think about what that means, you see. In Israel, women are like property. And Barak wants to hide by the skirts of Deborah. I'll only go if you come. So Deborah says, fine, I'll come with you. But here's what's going to happen. Everybody is going to say, God delivered them into the hands of a woman. Now, if there was ever a beacon for women leadership in the church, Deborah is it. After Deborah came Gideon. Now, Gideon wasn't sure that he was talking to God. So Gideon had to test God. Gideon lays out a fleece. This fleece. I have this wonderful fleece that my sister-in-law gave me for Christmas 2 years ago. It has the Starship Enterprise on the front of it. It sits on my easy chair, and I use it to warm up on cold evenings when I'm watching TV or listening to music. He laid out a fleece in the ground and said, okay, God, if it's truly you, now, you know, he's an angel talking to him. Come on. If it's truly you, make the dew fall on this fleece only. Next morning he gets up, he wrings out cups of water from the fleece and the ground is dry. Good enough for me. Not good enough for Gideon. Gideon says, well, let me make absolutely sure. Remember, I'm the least of my clan and my clan's the smallest, I'm afraid. I'll put the fleece out again, this time make the dew fall everywhere except on the fleece. Now, God was very good to Gideon. Usually, if I test God, I get it right quick. And then there was Samson. And you know the story of Samson. Samson was a mighty warrior, killed thousands of Philistines. But in the end, he had to depend upon God. Judges 6:15 says this. Gideon was speaking. But sir, how can I deliver Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. God says, go. But just to make sure that everyone knew this was God and not Gideon, God stacked the deck against Gideon. Gideon rounded up 32,000 warriors. God said, that's too many. Tell everyone who's afraid to go home. So just like that old army thing, everybody who volunteers take one step backwards, 22,000 step backwards. Now Gideon is left with 10,000 warriors. God said, that's too many. Take them all down to the river and watch. All those who lap at the water like an animal and see who kneels down and cups the water to drink. And keep the ones who cup the water to drink. Gideon follows instructions. Now he's down to 300 men. and listening outside the tents of Midian, he hears one of the Midianites who recounts a dream. And being assured of victory by having heard that dream, he tells his 300 men, take your trumpets, take your bowls and put candle in them, and we'll surround the camp, and when I give the word, blow the trumpet, break the bowls. Now the word of this dream is spread throughout Midian. They walk around, they blow the trumpets, they drop the bowls, all the Midianites freak out and kill each other. And Gideon didn't have to raise a hand. You see, God wanted to show his presence, his power, his plan. He wanted there to be no mistake about who had led the victory. So he chose the smallest clan and the weakest member of the clan, and reduced his army from 32,000 to 300. And they won the victory with trumpets and jars. No doubt, this was God. You see, when everyone else would have said, no way, Gideon said, Yahweh. And once again, the battle was won. Now, how does this in any way connect to us today? We tend to think of ourselves as the nation of God. I'm not sure why. God did not choose the United States to be his chosen nation. He chose Israel. Our country was founded on a deist philosophy with the idea of religious freedom. Now, for a time, this country chose God, and we prospered, and we won the battles, and on and on and on. But that is not the case today. This country has not chosen God. Who has chosen God? We have. So in the lower story, at a time like this, we may think God has abandoned us. I'm not making any kind of a political statement here. I am not recommending any candidate. But I hear everyone saying, what are we going to do on Tuesday? Because our choices are not great either way. Whatever. Here's what we do. We remember that God is in the upper story waiting for us to return to him with arms open wide. And if we return to him with arms into his wide open arms, we don't have to worry about who wins the election. Pray about who wins the election. But God is still God. And we are still his chosen people. And our job is not to worry, but to pray. And our job is to love the Lord our God with all our heart and all our soul and all our strength, and love our neighbor as ourselves and go and make disciples. That's our job. Seems like a daunting job. But if we will do like Gideon, when others say, no way, we say, Yahweh. We cannot fail. Let us pray. Lord God, help us to learn the lessons of the judges and the lessons of Israel. To remember to keep our eyes on you, to remember those things that you have done, those mighty works throughout history, but also in our own lives. Help us to live as one chosen by you. Help us. Be saints. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. And so we come to a time of communion, and it is also the celebration of All Saints Day. So there will be a time in this communion liturgy where we will light a candle for those who we have lost in the past year. And then as you come forward to receive communion, actually you're not going to come forward because it's in the pews. As you receive communion, if you have another you would like to add to the cloth, our memorial cloth, just come forward and write their name in as you receive communion. So please join me on page 12. In your hymnal, or 13 actually. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and the martyrs, God of our mothers and fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your holy name and join the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant, which we shall remember by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, you took bread. You gave thanks. You broke the bread and gave it to your disciples and said, "Take, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, you took the cup, gave thanks to God, and gave it to your disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the whole world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those we name before you now. Bessie Budney, Ruth Ada Ace, Clark Otis Smith, Paul Purple, Art Hilliard, Pat Davis, Bob Malsh, Marge Purple, and if there are others that you would recognize in your own life as you receive communion, add their name to our memorial cloth. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, by your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Communion stewards would come forward, please. We celebrate the open table. We believe the prevenient grace of Christ works through communion. All are welcome to join. We will pass the bread, take the bread, pass the cup, take the cup, and remember the saints that have gone before. soft as you drink it, remember me. Don't fall into the cycle. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Remember, you are a saint, chosen by God and given a special purpose. So go out there and do it. And remember, the worship team has provided you with coffee to go with those wonderful desserts at the back, and then you can come right on down to Sunday school. And then go out into the world and be God's grace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen. Thank you.